I'm getting it delivered on Friday, don't hear me. I thought it was going to be.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Father Al, I'm the pastor of St. Joan of Arc, and I'm glad to be here with you today as we celebrate this funeral for Ed. And we just know that wherever we are, we're always in God's presence. So be aware of God's loving presence with you today and every day of your life. So let's take a moment of silence and realize and call to mind all of our wonderful memories of Ed, and we commend him to the Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the grace and peace of God our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. My brothers and sisters, we've come here together to renew our trust in Christ Jesus, who by dying on the cross has freed us from eternal death, and by rising has opened for us the gates of heaven. Let us pray for our brother Edward, that he may share in Christ's victory. But let us pray also for ourselves, that the Lord may grant us the gift of his loving consolation. Let us pray. God of loving kindness, listen favorably to our prayers. Strengthen our belief that your Son has risen from the dead, and our hope that your servant Ed will also rise again. We ask this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever. Amen. And let us listen to a reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m, because of an eclipse of the sun. Then the veil of the temple was torn down the middle, and Jesus from the cross cried out in a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." And when he had said this, he breathed his last. Now there was a virtuous and righteous man named Joseph of Arimathea, who, though he was a member of the council, he went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. After he had taken the body down, he wrapped it in a linen cloth and laid him in a rock-hewn tomb in which no one had yet been buried. But at daybreak, on the first day of the week, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were puzzling over this, behold, two men in dazzling garments appeared to them. They were terrified and bowed their faces to the ground. They said to them, "Why do you seek the living one among the dead? He is not here. He has been raised." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Well, we come here, you know, we're in the middle of this Easter season, and at the heart of our Christian faith is what we call the Paschal Mystery, the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And that's what we celebrate in a very real way, a more intense way during this Easter season. We pray that Jesus died for us on the cross, but that on Easter Sunday he rose from the dead. But the important thing for us to remember today in a special way is that the death and resurrection is not just something that happened to Jesus, but rather it's what we are called to do, that we will one day die, but also it is our faith that tells us that we will rise again. You know, if we die with Christ, we rise with Christ. In many ways, Ed had an even closer connection to Jesus' death. He died on Good Friday, too. And we are here in the midst of this Easter season, and we celebrate that Ed will rise again, that one day we'll see Ed again in the resurrection of the dead. And that's our sure hope. That's at the heart of what it means to be a Christian, is that we have a belief that this world is not all there is, but rather we were created for something even greater. We were created for glory. We were created to be destined to live forever. It's an amazing thing when you think about it, what we Christians believe. But it is at the heart of our faith. Now, throughout the Gospels, Jesus tells us the ways in which we can one day see him again. And he says that in a very unique way in that one parable where he talks about the sheep and the shepherds. You know, at the end of time, in the resurrection of the dead, he'll say, Those who will be with me forever are the ones who were not only about themselves. Because that is at the heart of what it means to be a good person. That's what it means to be a Christian, is to live our lives for others. You know, and to live a simple life. In many ways, as I was talking to Sally yesterday, Ed had a simple life, you know. His whole life was his family and his friends. His whole life was about working hard, providing for his family, the simple things in life, you know, baseball, and going to the World Series, the College World Series, all those things. You know, I had to laugh too, because I don't know if you ever saw that movie, that was a play on Broadway too. It was called The Man Who Came to Dinner, who went to stay with somebody and then they never left, and that's what happened to that one. And in many ways, but what we celebrate is we celebrate a good man. I mean, that's all God expects of us. You know, for us to do the best we can. And most importantly, though, I really think this is so important in this world in which the world will tell us that the most important thing is money and being famous and being powerful. That's all wrong. Jesus tells us what's important. Loving the people God puts into our lives. Forgiving those who have hurt us and asking forgiveness of those who hurt. Of being faithful to the ones that we say we're going to be faithful to. Ultimately, the life of the good life, whatever the world tells us the good life consists of, the real good life is about being a person for others. Being a man or woman for others. I always say, you know, it's wonderful to love the people in China and Africa and South America, but if you can't get along with the people in your home, then you're missing out on something. You know? It really is about love and forgiveness and service and kindness. And we come here today and we say goodbye to a good man, a good and simple man. Someone who we believe with all our hearts is already with the Lord. And that we too will one day see him again. But as I say, you know, in many ways, Ed has already received his reward. We still have a ways to go yet, you know? None of us knows the day or the hour when the Lord's going to call us home. So in many ways, we have to live our lives always in anticipation for that day. And that means that as we come here today, we ask ourselves, am I a person who knows how to love? Am I a person who knows how to forgive? Am I holding grudges against somebody? Am I a person who this whole life is just all about me? Or is it about others? And I think the way we answer that question makes a huge difference in how we live this life. But also it makes a big difference in the life to come. So as we come here and we commend Ed to the Lord, let us, in many ways, promise to be like Ed. In living a good, simple life, a holy life, that's what a holy life is all about. It's not about being some plaster saint, but rather, it's being who God has created us to be. And then we really become who God created us to be when we finally see him face to face. Brothers and sisters, at the heart of our Christian faith is the death and resurrection of Jesus. But it is also at the heart of our faith that we too will one day die, but that we also will rise again. And then we will see one another again. I truly believe that we'll all be together again. You know, Ed has already seen his wife. He's already seen his two children. He's already had that reunion. And I believe that we'll all be reunited because of God's mercy and God's love. You know? Ultimately, when we meet the Lord face to face, he'll say, how did you live your life? And we'll be able to say, as Ed was able to say, Lord, I did the best I could. And the Lord said, that's enough. Do the best you can. As an old priest down in Philadelphia says, do your best and God will do the rest, okay? And ultimately, we'll all be together again. So let's take a moment and just call to mind all of our memories of Ed, commend him to the Lord. But as we come face to face with death, let us make a commitment that we ourselves will live good and simple and holy lives until the Lord calls us home. This time I'm going to ask Kenny to come forward. He's going to say a few words. Mm-hmm.
Play ball. We were going to the College World Series, and it was illegal early in the morning to fly out to Omaha. And we get to Jimmy's house, and it's like 5 in the morning, and he comes out of the car and he goes, "Play ball!" And he's yelling. He was so pumped. That was a big trip for us. And we're like, "Dad, it's 5 o'clock in the morning, and we're really digging that right now." But no, what a beautiful day. Perfect for Dad. That's what he talked about. Boy, it's a beautiful day. Yeah, it is. It's only fitting to start the tribute and celebration of Dad's Pop-Up's life with a hello and a those are some little quirks the guy had, and you know what? We can all laugh about it, and it'll be special forever. Over the last week, all of us have been blessed with and comforted by so many people who have reached out, either through text messages, calls, cards, or social media outlets in regards to Dad's passing, Pop-Up's passing. There were two words that kept being mentioned. Two words were incredible and legacy. Just kept resonating. When you look up the definition of incredible, you see extraordinary and amazing. And I can tell you, when he went to his doctor visits, they told him, like, his numbers, his vitals, and all these things were, "You're amazing, Ed. You're amazing, Ed. You're extraordinary." Like, and boy, would he tell us. "Hey, how'd the visit go?" "I was amazing. I'm amazing." So, yeah, the N word, Dad. Yep, no question about it. The doctors would say that to him, and then, and when you look up legacy, you see what it says. It says a person passes on that would impact others for a lifetime. And yes, that's what we're celebrating today, what he's passing on. Celebration of 96 complete full year, fulfilled years. As a representative of the family, Sally, Fran, Danny, Michael, Katie, thank you for welcoming him, loving him. Caring for him, tolerating him. Persevering and simply just your unconditional love for our father for 35 years. That hamburger, that turned into a long visit. Without that, I am confident, and I'm sure you all would agree, would not have been blessed for him for as long as we did. Because what that social network and that family structure did for him was what gave him longevity. No question. I'm sure I can speak for all of us that we are finding peace and comfort in Dad's passing, that he is reunited with Jane, Kelly, and Mom. There's no question about that. I can only imagine how incredible that moment is. And like Sally said, "You better behave, because he's going to kick his butt back down here." So, yeah, just over the last week of just putting things in my phone, you know, just some reminders. And we all have a little bit of Dad and Pop-Up in us. Like, grandkids, once you hear some of this and you go through your life, you're going to go, "I think that's a little bit of Pop-Up problem." Just want to share a few attributes, moments, memories, so that we can all connect with him. And this will never end, because we'll be, I catch myself at times going, "Oh boy," or something like that. I sound like Mom. But his work ethic, I mean, this guy worked 12, 14 hour days. We didn't see him a lot. We didn't. Like, it wasn't like we're sitting down having family dinners. Dad was working, providing for seven kids, and just trying to, you know, pay the bills and go paycheck to paycheck. Love and importance of family. It wasn't like he didn't love us. I mean, that was what his love was providing. You go into his room at Sally's, and you can see what he was all about, family. There's pictures everywhere and all the stuff he had in there. That's where his pride and joy was. Perseverance, you know, look, he lost his wife, you know, 58 years old. was able to persevere through that, losing two children, persevering through that. A toughness. The dude was tough. Like, he had some injuries that I was like, whoa, but he didn't flinch. So when we talk about toughness, like, we get that. Because he definitely had it. He fought till the end to get where he was. The newspaper, the importance of family, just buying newspapers. If he knew we were going to be in the headlines, he got up early to be the first one to meet the paper guy at the news agency to get not one paper, but like 10. Like, he just wanted to be the first one there to do that. Articles, pictures. Sally was saying how much stuff that he kept, because she had no idea of what he kept, and it just said what meant the most to him. He was quiet. He didn't say a whole lot, but I know there were times where we knew that he wasn't real happy. Like, he didn't have to say much. We just kind of had that sense, like, ooh, okay. Very quiet. Quiet leadership. Commitment to do what you had to do. He was a worker. Athleticism. I know Mom used to be like, hey, you get this from me. No, we got it from Dad, and we saw that good-looking guy over there in his uniforms, in those pictures. He loves sports. College World Series was a big thing for us going to Omaha. Man, I'll tell you what, we have video, and it is incredible. Like, we had a blast. I mean, it was days, a week long of food, laughs, and just baseball. Like, that's what we did. And he looked eat back then. Like, we didn't know if he was getting on with me, and he's like, where are we eating next? Hard to believe, and then he became very picky about it. The phone calls, like, just, you know, I miss those. And it could be 2 minutes, but it mattered. He liked to dance. He needed a beer or two, but he could dance. It took him a while to loosen up. I'll tell you what, and he'd get his old moves, man. Those little skinny legs were working and his hips, and he was moving and shaking. But Mom said he couldn't do the poker. She didn't really want to do the poker with him. But boy, I woke up to that today. Katie, I think, put something about when he was getting a card, and he loved to dance with those cards he'd buy there, you know, for Easter or whatever. If it had music to it, he's shaking. And then when you call, that was for, he didn't even say hello. He just had the music playing. Writing trivial things down. Oh my gosh. The guy wrote this stuff down, you're like, I need to keep that. But his mind was working. He had things down, a plan, even his bowel movements. I can tell you, he gets to a point where that's what it is. He's when he gets to a certain point of life, he's like, what up, Bill? Okay, that's great. He had a routine. Ooh, but did he have a routine? So when we get in our, you guys, we all feel that. We go, oh, that's Pop-Pop. And he was Mr. Routine. He had a calmness about him. Sometimes he didn't get really excited about stuff, and you'd be like, wow, why isn't he getting so excited? Quick story. We had a car. We lived right here on Railroad Street. It was sitting in front of the house, and it's a different direction now because it's a one-way. It used to go downhill. We had a Dodge Colt, and one day it jumped out of gear, and it rolled down the hill and rolled into a tree sitting in front of the National Hotel. So a neighbor, somebody come over and go, hey, isn't that your car that's out here? And my dad goes, oh, yeah, that's a good place for it. Come back in the house. Didn't faze him at all. They were just like, oh, you should go get it. But again, he brought a sense of calm there to some of those situations. Sometimes you're like, do you have a pulse? Like, what's going on? Eat the same things. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm the youngest of seven, so guess what? I was the last out of the house, so I'm really picky. And I know we all have little quirks about eating, but he was, wow, as you all know, he liked things a certain way and only certain things, for sure. His rub-offs, love those. He loved to win, and he won a lot. He loved to win. Telling stories that he liked to run. Dad just got back from a run. I mean, 3 weeks ago, that's what he was talking about. He said, I didn't even have to move my legs today. He said, the wind just took me. telling stories, you know, if you got him going on his grandkids or his family, that was very quiet, but once you got him there, boy, he didn't stop. Whether it's a doctor's office or somebody that, if you open that door to talk about that, he was gonna go. You're gonna hear. Sense of humor. He was a funny guy. Like, there's some one-liners he'd throw out. He was good. He was funny for being a quiet guy. I'm getting personal here. Kim, every day he'd say, "How's Kim doing? Does she have her feet up?" "I got my feet up." He said, "But I don't know if they're going back down." She started playing piano in her retirement. So he would say, "Hey, tell her to call me 3 a.m. Give me a little ding. Call me, play piano for me." Music cards, I mentioned he loved those. Writing things down. He would have worked forever if it wasn't for injury. That guy would have worked. He would have kept going. He had an unfortunate injury with his hand that kind of short made his working career end there a little bit early, but he would have worked because he was a worker. He worked his mind as well, which I think is so valuable for all of us. Like, he always worked his mind, crossword puzzles, word searches, just keeping sharp, kept moving. Guy was driving until he's 94, and then took away his own license. Because he just didn't feel comfortable. Competitive. He hated to lose. Like, I think the client genes are like, yeah, we don't like to lose. He didn't like to lose at all. Whether it was pool, he was a really good pool player. You couldn't get him out of the bar sometimes because he was running the table. That's what I hear. I know, they said how good he was. Bowling, apparently he was a stud bowler. Basketball, baseball, just those athletic talents. I know Mom, sorry, but I think Dad rubbed off a little bit. So really, and in closing, I just want to say, wow, we're gonna miss him. And I
say a few words. Pop-Pop and I became roommates when I was 3. And when I say roommates, Mike, Pop-Pop, and me share a bedroom together. So whenever my daughters complain about how small the bedrooms are, I remind them. So needless to say, he was patient, he was understanding, and he was reliable. But as Kenny was just alluding to, my greatest takeaway from Pop-Pop was just his sense of humor and just never taking himself too seriously. Some of his greatest hits of jokes included watch the ice at Slippy during the summer months, talking about making sure his arm was ready for spring training. Kenny was talking about the conversations, and you all were on one side of it, but we'd hear that conversation 4 or 5 times. I remember when it was the craze from one commercial when they were saying, "What's up?" When he found that out, we heard that on repeat all day long. And I also just want to take a moment and just thank my parents, especially my mom, just for everything that she did to provide care for him over the years. I can't imagine how many grilled cheeses we made over those years. I did make one last summer, and he told me it was tasty, which was probably one of the nicest things he had. Yeah, but he told me I didn't cut it the right way. And it was the wrong plate. But there you go. Yeah.
Call you from upstairs.
We're all figuring it out. I mentioned all of things that he's great at. Another thing that he was great at was driving my mom crazy. So though I'm happy to take that baton and move it forward. But just in closing, if you want to honor his legacy, it's enjoy your life and love your family. That's what he was all about. Thank you.
Almighty Father raised Christ, his Son, from the dead. With confidence, we ask him to save all of his people living in him. In response to these intercessions, will be, Lord, hear our prayer. For Ed, who in baptism was given the pledge of eternal life, that he may now be admitted to the company of the saints, we pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For our brother who ate the body of Christ, the bread of life, that he may be raised up on the last day, we pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For all our deceased relatives and friends, and for all who have helped us in any way in this life, that they may have the reward of their goodness, we pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For those who have fallen asleep in the hope of rising again, that they may see God face to face, we pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. For the family and friends of our brother, that they may be consoled in their grief by the Lord, who wept at the death of his friend Lazarus, we pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. And for all of us assembled here to worship in faith, that we may all be one day gathered together again in God's kingdom, we pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. And let us bring to mind all of our own most personal needs and the needs of our individual. We pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer. God, our shelter and our strength, you listen in love to the cry of your people. Hear the prayers we offer for all of our departed brothers and sisters. Cleanse them of their sins and grant them the fullness of redemption through Christ our Lord. Amen. And let us bring together all of our prayers into one as we pray the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet it yet again, when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself. Into your hands, Father of mercies, we commend our brother Edward, in the sure and certain hope that together with all who have died in Christ, he will rise with him on the last day. We give you thanks for the many blessings which you bestowed upon him in this life. They are signs to us of your goodness and of our fellowship with the saints in Christ. Merciful Lord, turn toward us and listen to our prayers. Open the gates of paradise to your servant and help us who remain to comfort one another with assurances of faith until we all meet in Christ and are with you and with our brother forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. May the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. May choirs of angels welcome you and lead you to the bosom of Abraham. And where Lazarus is poor no longer, may you find eternal rest. Now in peace, we'll take our brother to his final place. Yeah, my heart.